Steve, why don't you start? Oops, sorry. Steve, why don't you start reading the announcements? Then we'll move into roll call.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is Stephen Tupper, Cape Cod Commission staff. A few announcements to start off the Cape Cod MPO meeting of June 27th, 2022. The meeting will be held virtual with all members of the Cape Cod Metropolitan Planning Organization participating remotely pursuant to Chapter 20 of the Acts of 2021, an act relative to extending certain COVID-19 measures adopted during the state of emergency. If anyone is having a technical issue, use either the chat box on your screen or call 508-362-3828 and staff will assist you. Participants wishing to speak, please use the raise hand function, which can be accessed by clicking the raised hand icon on the toolbar. Telephone participants should press *9, again, *9 to indicate they wish to speak, and *6 to unmute themselves. All participants will be muted until called on by the chair. Just a couple more announcements. This meeting is being recorded. Let's ask if anyone can please raise your hand to notify the chair if you're also recording this meeting. I'll let you know if someone raises their hand. Meeting materials and the meeting recording, when available, can be accessed at capecodcommission.org/MPO. Because members will be participating remotely, we will be taking a roll call action on each vote we take. I will note we have a number of quick items coming up with votes, so please be ready for your voting action. And we ask members to please state their name when making the motion to assist with minute taking. And that's it, Mr. Chair.
All right, I assume Phil's on the in the meeting, so Phil, could you do the roll, please?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel.
Stephen Wolfel representing, I think I talked to you about acting is no longer acting, Secretary and CEO of MassDOT, Jamie Tesler. So I'm here, Phil.
Sure. Pamela Hasner.
Pamela Hasner here representing MassDOT Highway Administrator Jonathan Gulliver.
Harold Mitchell.
Here, representing Cape Cod Commission.
Robert Lawton.
Present.
Mark Forrest.
I am present, representing the Barnstable County Commissioners.
Brian Whedon. Dan Santos. Judith McLeod Froman.
Present, representing Subregion A, Bourne, Falmouth, Mashpee, and Sandwich.
Tom Andrade.
Present, sitting in for Cheryl McMahon.
Kevin Galligan.
Kevin Galligan present, representing Subregion C, Brewster, Chatham, Harwich, and Orleans.
And Robert Weinstein. And any ex officio members representing Cape Cod Joint Transportation Committee, National Park Service, Cape Cod National Seashore, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Cape Cod Canal, Woods Hole, Martha's Vineyard, and Nantucket Steamship Authority, Federal Highway Administration, and Federal Transit Administration. Mr. Chair, we have a quorum.
All right, thanks, Phil. Thank you, everybody. Welcome. We'll move on to the next agenda item, which is potential approval of the prime meeting minutes, which were for May 23rd, 2022. Can I get a motion and a second to approve?
Harold Mitchell motions to accept the minutes as written.
Kevin Galligan, second.
All right, anyone have any comments or questions on the minutes? Seeing none, Phil, you want to read the roll?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel?
Yes.
Pamela Hasner?
Staying, I was absent.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Judith McLeod Froman?
Abstain.
Tom Andrade?
Abstain.
And Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right, thank you everyone. Let's move on to agenda item 4, which is public comments. Any of the members of the public would like to address the MPO today? Steve and Phil, I don't see any names or hands up. Do you?
I do not, Mr. Chair.
All right, let's move to agenda item five, which is federal fiscal year 22 to 26 TIP amendment number three. Who's going to be doing this, Steve? Is it you or?
It'll be me, Colleen Medeiros.
Colleen, I didn't see you. Go ahead, Colleen.
Good afternoon, everyone. As you recall, last month we presented TIP Amendment 3 for federal fiscal years 2022 to 2026. We opened it up based on your vote for a 21-day public comment period. And during that public comment, we received none. So today we'd be looking for a vote to endorse TIP Amendment 3. TIP Amendment 3 includes price adjustments for the following two projects: Dennis Route 6A over the Sesuit Creek Culvert replacement project, with the current cost is at around $4.5 million. And the amendment funds the remaining approximately $3 million using a combination of regional and statewide funds. The next project is a Harwich Azalea Drive Bridge replacement project. The current total project cost is approximately $3.9 million. And the amendment funds the additional remaining $2 million using statewide funds. So happy to answer any questions. These projects will be moving forward into construction as the next step, and you'll be seeing these on the ground soon.
All right, thanks, Colleen. Can I get a motion a second to approve Amendment 3 and to endorse, and then I'll open it to questions.
Mr. Chair, this is Kevin Galligan. Given these are in my sub-region, I would move approval of TIP Amendment 3 as proposed.
All right, thank you, Kevin. Is there a second?
Second, Perlman.
Mitchell.
Judith, are you deferring to Harold?
Sure.
All right. Any questions anyone has or comments? All right, seeing none, Phil, you want to read the roll, please?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel?
Yes.
Pamela Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Judith McLeod Froman?
Yes.
Tom Andrade?
Yes.
And Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
Thank you, everybody. All right, so we have agenda item six is next, which is federal fiscal year 2022 to 2026 TIP adjustment. Colleen?
Yes, so today we have an adjustment, not an amendment, for the 2022 to 2026 TIP. Next slide. So this adjustment is regarding the currently programmed transit project to purchase 8 low floor cutaway buses. Currently the cost is $996,222. The funding is coming from a variety of sources through FTA and some state capital funds. The adjustment now is to still purchase the same buses, so it'll be the same project, but now the cost is approximately $1.2 million, and it's going to be using just solely state capital funds. So this does not need to go out for a 21-day public comment period, as it's considered an adjustment to a current project, and it's just mainly switching the sources of funding. So today we're just looking for a vote to endorse this TIP adjustment.
All right, can I get a motion a second to endorse the TIP adjustment? I'll open up to any questions afterwards.
Robert Lott, I'll move to approve.
Is there a second?
I'll second Mitchell.
All right. Any questions for Colleen? Seeing none, Phil, you want to read the roll?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel?
Yes.
Pamela Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Judith McLeod Froman?
Yes.
Tom Andrade?
Yes.
And Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right, thank you, everyone. We'll move on to agenda item 7, which is federal fiscal year 2022 to 2026 amendment number 4. Colleen.
Okay, so this is the last, hopefully the last TIP amendment for this federal fiscal year. It should read 2022 to 2026. So this is a last change, and it's related to the Sandwich Service Road shared use path, as well as a couple other items. So TIP amendment 4 includes the Sandwich Service Road shared use path. It's currently project cost is around $12.6 million. It was previously obligated for around $8.4 million using statewide CMAC funds. So the amendment would fund the remaining approximately $4.2 million using additional statewide CMAC funds. And then this project will go out for bid for construction later this year. All right, and for the next amendment 4 includes purchase of transit vehicles through the State Mobility Assistance Program. So the MassDOT Rail and Transit Division has awarded FTA 5310 funds, and a state match would fund the purchase of these transit vehicles through the state's Mobility Assistance Program. This is for the mobility of seniors and individuals with disabilities. So Amendment 4 would add this funding category totaling approximately $796,728 to federal fiscal year 2022. We're also, with this potential vote, we're looking, instead of doing a 21-day public comment period, looking as part of this for a 14-day public comment period, just because we are under a tighter timeline because of we could not meet last Monday due to the holiday. So in order to get public comments reviewed and distributed in advance of the July 18th MPO meeting, we're looking for a 14-day public comment period associated with Amendment 4 and potential endorsement for Amendment 4 at the July meeting.
And I assume, Colleen, the shortened time frame is allowed by the MOU, right? But,
Steve, you want to just verify that?
Correct. It's allowed so long as it's identified specifically by the MPO, and we've given the reasoning here to allow time to distribute the comments.
Okay. I figured. I just want to double check. All right. Does anyone want to make a motion a second to send TIP Amendment 4 out for public review with the shortened time frame as recommended by staff?
Harold Mitchell, I'll make a motion.
Is there a second?
Second by Kevin Galligan. Mr. Chair, I do have one quick question.
All right, so a motion second. Go ahead, Kevin.
Colleen and everyone, I know we love our little acronyms, but for anyone listening, could you describe what CMAC is, please? And that's my question.
Oh, this is a good, let me see. It's congestion mitigation air quality. Is that?
That's correct.
Yeah, very good.
So it's primarily using, it's definitely supportive for a bike path project. So we're trying to get people out of vehicles to reduce the air, improve air quality, reduce emissions. So that's the primary focus of this funding category through the highway division.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
Any other questions? All right, seeing none. Phil, you want to read the roll?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel?
Yes.
Pamela Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Judith McLeod Froman?
Yes.
Tom Andre?
Yes.
And Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right. Thank you, Phil. Thank you, Colleen, for all those. We'll move on to our next agenda item, which is agenda item 8, update on the public participation plan, which I believe is Jessica.
I will be filling in for Jessica today, Mr. Chair.
All right, go ahead, Steve.
Thank you again, Stephen Tupper. Just give you a quick update on the public participation plan. So a couple slides here. Just to review that overall, it provides the mechanism by which the MPO does their public outreach activities. So I'm gonna go over two slides to highlight what was released for public comment by the MPO at the last meeting, and then look for a potential vote for extending the public comment period. So again, the PPP dictates how we do early and continuous and meaningful opportunities for the public to take part in our transportation decision-making process. And there are a couple key updates as part of this update to the public participation plan, making sure that it's consistent with updated US DOT orders, incorporating measures of effectiveness, incorporating US DOT Title VI guidance for community participation plans, and to identify the virtual participation options that are now part of the overall outreach approach for the MPO. So we've began our outreach activities, but given that we have some time before we need to approve this plan, we're requesting the MPO extend the public comment period through the end of August. That'll give us additional opportunities for public outreach. We'll do some events over the summer as well, virtual and some in-person pop-up events to get some feedback on the potential changes to the document. And the idea of the August 31st deadline is that'll give us time to collect comments and bring them to the MPO ahead of the August meeting. Ahead of the September meeting. We're going to try to cancel the August meeting. And I know we try to give you some time in the summer, so we'll do our best. We'll be doing outreach, and hopefully we'll be able to skip an MBO meeting in August. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions or entertain a motion, Mr. Chair.
All right. Any questions for Steve? I don't see any questions. So is anyone willing to make a motion, a second, to extend the public comment period through to August 31st?
Harold Mitchell, I'll make the motion.
Is there a second?
Robert Lawton, I'll second.
All right, any questions? All right, Phil, you wanna read the roll?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel?
Yes.
Pamela Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Judith McLeod Froman?
Yes.
Tom Andrade?
Yes.
And Kevin Galligan?
Yes.
The motion passes.
All right, thank you for that, Steve. Thank you, everyone. We'll move on to the next agenda item, the bicycle crossing inventory. Steve, who's doing this?
Our transportation planner, Evan Mormon, will give an update on a project we recently closed out.
All right, go ahead, Evan.
Hello, let me request control. Okay, let's see if that works. I don't see it moving. David, can you move? Are you able to move the screen? Mine seemed to have frozen.
Can you see that move, Devin? It looks like you've kind of locked up as well.
Okay. Wait a minute.
If you had the presentation open, you can move through it on your machine and I'll just move the slides as you need. They are moving here.
Oh, they're moving there. Okay. Let me, on the bicycle crossing inventory. So as we all know, as most of us know, Cape Cod has, we have a really high quality, extensive series of rail trails all throughout the Cape. And we're extending them all the time. Right, that's a lot of what we're working on. So this project was aiming to look at, you know, make this comprehensive inventory, provide this update view on what exactly do we have and where, what shape are the crossings in and what component. So to that end, we inventoried 95 unique crossings in 11 of our 15 towns. Next slide, please. So we were inspired, we should note, by the Pioneer Valley MPO, who produced a really interesting study several years ago in which they inventoried 71 different crossings in 12 different towns. So a little bit smaller, but same basic scale. And so we took basically their ideas, made some changes to fit the region, and came up with our project. So the data was collected in 2020. There were some spot checks that were done in the fall of 2021 to make sure we had the most up to date. Importantly, we only looked at at-grade crossings. We did not look at bridges, tunnels, anywhere where we didn't cross, where there wasn't an at-grade crossing. We looked at crashes using the MassDOT impact tool within race of the... And data was kind of broken down into two sections, the road approach and the trail approach. So here are just some images team that was out in the field. And as I said, summer. And I won't go over all of these if you look at the next slide, but we looked at the road approach and the rail trail approach. So you can see there's some, you know, each approach has its own unique characteristics, right? To the safety of that crossing. So for example, on the road approach, we have advanced warning signs, shared use path signs, yield markings. And we inventoried, you know, the control type, whether it's stop controlled, you know, yield controlled, things that are maybe a little bit objective, like sight distance. I seem to have been lost.
We can still hear you, Evan. You're a little bit choppy. If you okay. do lose, I can always take over, but we can't hear you right now.
Lost my... Let me see if I can get that back. My apologies. Give me one.
If you don't mind, Mr. Chair, it sounds like Evan's having some connection issues. We also have Dave Nolan, who is on the project, and he'd be willing to step in and close out the presentation if you'd like.
Sure.
Happy to do so, Steve. I was anticipating this could happen if Evan was going to drop out there. So I'll take it from here. So Evan kind of quickly showed you here the specific data that was collected about the road approach to the crossing, as well as the rail trail approach to the crossing. David, could you go to the next slide, please? So in the report, which, you know, Evan actually put together for us after the data collection process was completed, we included the draft inventory report and brought that forward to the Cape Cod Joint Transportation Committee. And we let them kind of review the data and offer us any more insight to their crossings, if they had done any upgrades since we had collected the data, if they knew if anything that was coming in the near term. Then they helped us with some of the recommendations, kind of looking at types of projects that they'd like to see at our at-grade crossings. So we had an introductory section with basic design guidance and links to the formal design guides. We had some summary statistics Cape-wide from all of our crossings, looking at the number of, you know, like Evan kind of said earlier, we inventoried signage. So we looked at like all the crossings that had certain signage or flashing rapid beacons, things of that nature. There was a photo inventory. So we had a photo or several from every crossing that we inventoried, and then some crossing treatment options that we thought the towns would be able to point to for future projects. Next slide, please. So collecting the data, this is kind of what you'll see in the report. Kind of shows you the data that was collected on the left side with some of the photos of the crossings on the right side. So you could go more specifically to your region or your town to get a kind of get the breadth of the detail in each crossing in your community or in your region to kind of see what kind of information we uncovered. Next slide, please. So I'm not going to read everything here. I'll leave that to those that are really interested in diving into the details in the report. But these are some of the crossing treatment options that we put into the final report. So basically, the inventory was used for infrastructure maintenance or infrastructure improvements. So on the right side there, we basically wanted to do this so that people knew, you know, what was happening in their community, but also what was happening in other communities, some of those newer crossings. So that way we can, you know, start to improve the safety at all of our at-grade crossings along the trail network. We'll go to the next slide, please. One of the cool pieces to this project was we did put together a web application. We have our GIS team that always does a great job at this type of work for us. So accompanying the PDF report, we have a web tool on our website where you can actually go to each crossing location and actually select it, and it'll bring up a little pop-up with all of the information that we collected during our inventory. So you can kind of, like I said, it's a nice easy way for you to get to your town or your region to look at those crossings that you're most interested about. So you can find that on the website. There's a link there at the bottom. I know the slides will go out after, so feel free to take a look at that as well and play around. Next slide, please. So stage two of this project. We had a recommendation from the JTC. I guess they were fairly pleased with the inventory that we had worked on. So what they had recommended was us looking at some of our side paths. Those are the shared use path or the wide sidewalks along our roadway network, not so much part of that Cape Cod rail trail or the bike path network, but these are our on system paths. So what we've begun this summer is to start collecting data at these crossing locations in our region. And we're basically going to follow the same blueprint as the rail trail crossing report into a side path crossing report. So we'll inventory signage, pavement, crashes, crosswalk type and distance, and a slew of other things. So think some of those paths, Route 28 and Hyannis, that has a shared use path, Great Neck Road and Mashpee, Route 134 in Dennis. Those are just some of the locations that we're going to be looking at over the next year plus for this crossing inventory. Next slide, please.
You are at the end of the slides, Dave.
Well, that sounds good to me. So I suppose if anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to take any.
All right. Anyone have any questions? Kevin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Never shy on particularly bike path questions. And again, thanks so much for doing this work. And I have a suggestion, and again, not to steal Pam's thunder when she probably will give us an update on the support for future work on the East Ham Orleans Rotary, but just call your guys' attention to maybe expanding this in the future, David, Evan, Steve, on connectors to bike trails. And I think of this from the standpoint of the Orleans East Ham Rotary from the old state highway. There's a lot of crossing that occurs informally. It's extremely concerning to me from a safety standpoint. Right now we see lots of J1 students that have housing in East Ham that work, you know, for example, in Orleans. They use that old state highway that crosses busy Route 6, get over to East Ham, and sometimes they'll jump on the bike trail off of, I think it's called Smith Lane, over by the old courthouse, or head up to East Ham. And I just do think that as we look at this rotary redesign and project, this has got to be part of the improvements, has got to be. So thank you.
All right, other questions? All right, oh, Pam, go ahead.
Well, I just wanted to respond to Kevin's comment. when we did look to initiate the project and saw the close vicinity to the rail trail, we did include that as part of the study area. Regardless, we would look at a shared use path or some sort of a complete streets improvement on the project, but we are looking at that, or we will be. It was just recently initiated, so we haven't really done anything yet, but it was in our thoughts when it was initiated.
Thank you, Pam. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thanks, Pam. Thank you, Kevin. Anyone else? All right. Thank you, Evan. Thank you, Dave. Let's move on to the next agenda item, which are reports. Do we have any reports on our side?
Yes, we do have a report regarding the Cape Cod Bridge Program. Okay. So on May 23rd, the United States Army Corps of Engineers jointly applied with MassDOT for $1.113 billion in federal infra and mega funding to help replace the Bourne and Sagamore bridges. This funding request is part of the first round of the multimodal project discretionary grant opportunity and would support work to both replace the aging bridges and improve the adjoining roadway network. The grants, known statutorily as the National Infrastructure Project Assistance and Infrastructure for Building America programs, are administered by the U.S. Department of Transportation using funds from the bipartisan infrastructure law. Additionally, MassDOT and the USACE anticipate submitting an application for funding through the U.S. Department of Transportation's new competitive bridge investment program.
All right, any questions? I know I'm not up to speed on things, but if you have questions, first members, Steve, and then I'll cut to you. Any members have questions? All right, seeing none, Steve, go ahead.
Hi, Steve Buckley from Chatham. Is the application available anywhere online to review?
I don't know, Steve. We'll have to find out. I haven't been really that involved, so I can find out, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? All right. So I think that's all we have for Arisa. Thank you, Arisa. I think that's what we all have for MassDOT. So can we go back to the other reports? Is anyone from the Cape Cod RTA here today?
Hi, this is Leah LaCrosse. I'm here from Cape Cod.
Take it away.
Okay. I apologize to everybody. My camera seems to be not functioning today, but I will still be happy to give a report. The CCRTA continues to gear up for the 4th of July holiday and the increased ridership that that will bring. And right now, we're continuing our efforts to transition towards electric vehicles, and we're working on a plan to do so that would be a most efficient use of dollars, of federal and state dollars, and to do so in the most responsible way. Other than that, I think we're close to launching our new website, and that should be coming along within the next 2 to 3 weeks. So we look forward to having an update for you then on next meeting. And that's all.
All right, anyone have any questions for Leah?
No.
All right, thank you, Leah.
Thank Pam, you.
Pam, are we supposed to go back and go over projects?
Barbara LaChance can go over
Barbara here? Updates.
I am.
Yes.
Sorry, I missed that.
That's okay.
That's good, Barbara. Okay.
Good afternoon, everybody. Barbara LaChance from District 5. Project updates for you. The Orleans intersection improvements at Route 28, 39, and Quonset Road. This project, the bids were opened on this project with Lawrence Lynch as the I believe it was awarded to Lawrence Lynch, the low bidder. The Dennis culvert replacements on 6A over Sesuit Creek. This project is currently at 100%, and we anticipate the PSNE for this the end of July. The Harwich Bridge replacement, Azalea Drive over Herring River. The PSNE Revision 1 review was completed for this project, and it's moving towards an August advertising. The Sandwich, construction of the shared use path on Service Road from Route 130 to Chase Road. We are awaiting the PSNE on this project, which will be scheduled for advertising in August. Barnstable, the shared use path along Beers' Way from 28 to Pitcher's Way is currently at 75%. We anticipate the 100% the end of July for this project. The Wellfleet intersection improvements, Route 6 and Main Street is currently at 100%. We anticipate a comment resolution meeting soon for this, moving towards PSNE. The Wellfleet pavement preservation project is at 75% with the 100% anticipated in September for that project. The Bourne rotary improvements is the 25% for that are currently in and came in June, and they are currently under review. Provincetown, Shank Painter Road from Route 6 to Bradford Street is currently at 25%. The revised 25% have been submitted and are currently under review. the Dennis Harwich Route 28 from Upper County to Herring River Bridge project. We are looking to schedule a utility meeting for this project, hoping for July so that it can move on to design public hearing. The Harwich sidewalk installation 28 from Bank Street to Sacotucket Harbor, 25% are in on that one also, and that is currently under review. The Harwich Elementary School Safe Routes to School project, we are waiting on a 25% design submission for that project. The Dennis Yarmouth Bridge Replacement, Route 28 over the Bass River Bridge. This one is a combined project. I believe those two projects combined together. Design public hearing was held, and I don't have any further update on this, but I do have an email to the project manager to get an update on it. The Yarmouth Barnstable Cape Cod Rail Trail, phase three. 75% have been completed for this. We are awaiting 100% submission, which we anticipate in July. See, Mashpee 151 phase two is currently at 75% with 100% anticipated the end of July. The Barnstable resurfacing on Route 6 currently is 10% due in July for that project also. The Bourne Median installation project on Route 6, 25% are anticipated for that project end of July. The Bourne Rail Trail phase one is currently at 25% with the 75% anticipated at the end of July. And two more to go. The Chatham intersection project, Route 28, Depot Road and Queen Anne Road and Crow Road. The DJW review has been completed, and we do need a revised schedule for this project. And last but not least, the Dennis Carter and Streetscape Improvements on Main Street, Uncle Bonnie's Road to Old Main Street, phase two. The design consultant is currently working on concepts for this project. And that's what I have for my updates today. Thank you.
All right, anyone have any questions for Barbara? Seeing none, thank you, Barbara, for the update.
Thank you.
Oh, wait, who?
There's a couple of us.
See, they're not showing up. So who was it? Was it Judith and Kevin, I heard?
I think Kevin.
All right, Mark Forrest, I have a question too.
All right, so Judith go first, and then Kevin, who is the third one?
Mark Forrest.
All right, Mark, who go third? All right, go, Judith.
Okay, Belmont Circle. I know they're wrapping up for the season, I think tomorrow or something like that. Do we feel like they get to what their expectations were for completion for this phase of it and then pick up in September?
I got an update from our construction section, actually, at a meeting earlier today, and it sounds like we're in good shape. Unfortunately, there's a utility pole that needs to be moved before the last pedestrian activated signal can get in. So those will not be active until after the summer shutdown. But generally, the project is in very good shape, and there will be some, you know, after Labor Day, after the summer shutdown, we'll get back there and wrap it up. I don't have the end date for it. There may be some off-road work as long as there's no disturbance by utility companies to do, I think it's Verizon, to do splicing, but if that becomes an issue, they'll not continue, but everything should be off the road, so there shouldn't be any impacts to traffic.
Thank you. That's just what I needed. Thank you.
All right, Kevin?
Thanks, Mr. Chair. So my question is, and it's not really a question, but is there enough going on, everyone? Barbara, thanks so much for an update. I really do just sincerely wish to thank MassDOT, our local office, and everybody that's involved. There are so many projects moving on, and these are going to be tremendous improvements in the safety of multimodal transportation. Keep up the great work, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. All right, Mark, go ahead.
I want to echo Kevin's comments as well. There is quite a bit of work here, and oftentimes we feel a little bit left behind here on Cape Cod. So we appreciate all the attention Two questions real quick on the Yarmouth Barnstable Rail Trail bike trail project. What was the latest cost estimate on that, Barbara? Do you have, anybody have any update on that? That would be helpful. And if you don't have it today, you can just email me that information. That would be helpful.
Okay.
And if you could email me that, Barbara, that would be fine. I don't want to hold up the meeting for that.
Okay.
The other item is the Route 28 work from one end of Yarmouth to the other. And I'm just curious where we are at design-wise on that. Is that 25, 50?
I think I can answer both of these. I just, from the spreadsheet that Barbara gave me right before the meeting, it looks like she probably hasn't had time to go through it yet, but the estimate right now for the Yarmouth Barnstable Rail Trail is 12.2 million. And as she mentioned, it's we're expecting the 100s this summer. It's at 75% design. The Yarmouth Route 28 project, that's the one that goes from basically the Barnstable Town Line to Parker River Bridge, I think.
Yes.
That was programmed, and then it unfortunately, due to funding and other projects, it was removed from the TIP. However, it is at 25% design. We're still moving ahead with it. And it's at 25% design, but we're looking at some revisions and potentially phasing depending on available funds. And I know the Cape Cod Commission is looking at the section from basically Main Street to tie into the ongoing Route 28 Yarmouth Road project. So not to leave a 1,000 to 2,000 foot gap at most. We had asked, our designer to get survey for that section. And, we would think to have connectivity along the full length. There were a couple of different concepts at Main Street and then further east that our designer is looking at, and then we'll be meeting with the town and other stakeholders just to review the concepts.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You all set, Mark?
Yep, I am, thank you.
All right, any other members? All right, seeing none, Steve, go ahead.
Steve Buckley from Chatham, just a suggestion. If the PowerPoint, of course, just lists projects without the update status. So I realize you don't want to put too much information on a PowerPoint, but if the spreadsheet that Ms. Hasnar was referring to was made available at least in the packet for today, then for people who are wanting to know what's going on with a particular project can look it up and not have to go through a video and listen. So if there was text someplace, that would be very helpful, especially to the public. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. We'll figure that out. Thank you for the comment. Anyone else? All right, let's go to the last report, which I believe, or I'm guessing, is the actual commission itself.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I'll take that. Steve. And do want to note that all of the updates provided by MassDOT are included in each meeting minutes. There's actually a table with each of the projects and the status that we get from District 5. So understood that happens after the meeting, but that's the way that we're currently capturing the updates from MassDOT. But a couple of upcoming events to highlight. We're in the middle of our Barnstable Complete Streets Prioritization Plan process with the town of Barnstable. Got 5 public meetings that are going to be scheduled in July and early August, and a public comment period through the end of August. And also an online public comment tool so that folks can either attend the meetings and or submit the comments on the public comment tool. Looking forward to this one. Obviously, it's a very big town. It's a big planning process for us, but looking forward to the plan. Next, I wanted to highlight a program by the Cape Lake Compact. They have a e-bike incentive program specifically for lower income households to subsidize the cost of an electric bike. I get a lot of questions about why. And then the short answer is that we've found that there are some folks that have the ability to get to a number of destinations almost with a bike, but it seems a little bit out of range. So the idea is that this extends the range for some people to be able to make the trips they need to in this sort of program. Makes that cost of that much more affordable. So provides up to 75% off of the bike. That happens at point of sale, so they don't have to bring the money up front. It also covers maintenance of the bike and safety gear to make sure they have the bike lights and the helmets and the stuff they need to be safe out there. They also have a professional fitter at the local bike shops that are partnering as part of this program to make sure they understand how to use the bike. So we want to make sure that it's done in a safe manner. All the information on the program is up at capelightcompact.org/ebikerebate. Next, I wanted to highlight Cape Cod Commission's bike rack program. So we've done a few rounds of this, but this is the closeout of our current round of funding. We still have a good amount of funding left. So if any municipalities or other public entities have locations where they'd like to install a bike rack, fix-it station, associated infrastructure for bikes, please reach out to commission staff. Applications are due by September, but certainly I would encourage everyone to reach out earlier given some of the delivery times that we've been seeing with these installations. And everything must be completed by the end of 2022. And then finally, just a nod to some work that MassDOT is doing. I want to continue to spread the word about MassDOT's statewide long-range transportation plan. Some information up here about ways to connect with the process, but we want to make sure that everyone in the Cape Cod region is aware of this and has the ability to contribute to this long-range plan being developed by MassDOT. And that's it, Mr. Chair.
Thanks. Any questions for Steve? All right, seeing none, thank you, Steve. Let's move to the next agenda item, which I believe is new business. Is there anything new business to report? Judith, go ahead.
Thanks. I don't really have anything to report, but I am interested in knowing on our next meetings what the status of the new bridges is. I know we have the funding for that aspect of it, but because it's kind of quiet, we're curious about what's going on. So thank you.
Yep. We'll work to get a fuller update on that next month, Judith, if that works. Okay.
Thanks.
Steve, do you have any new business?
Nope, only to highlight again, we will be meeting on July 18th. We'll have to take a vote up for Amendment 4 of the TIP, so that's an important one. And we'll see if there's any other agenda items that get added, but certainly we do appreciate members showing up in terms of voting on that item.
All right, well, let's move to the last agenda item, which is adjourn. Can I get a motion second to adjourn, please?
So moved, Mr. Chair, this is Kevin.
Is there a second?
Second, Pam.
All right. Phil, you want to read the roll?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Stephen Wolfel?
Yes.
Pam Hasner?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell? Robert Lawton?
Yes.
Mark Forrest?
Yes.
Judith McLeod Froman?
Yes.
Tom Andre?
Yes.
And Kevin Galgan?
Yes.
The motion to adjourn passes.
All right. Thank you, everybody. We got a lot of stuff done today. As Steve said, we'll hopefully have a relatively quick meeting to deal with Amendment 4. Everyone stay safe and enjoy your 4th of July, and we'll see you in July. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.